Is this where you pull the rabbit out of the hat?
How's that? Is that okay?
Yep.
Yep. Okay. If things go wrong, make gestures. Taking Cinderella to the ball. Well, I should start by apologizing for my title. For if hope is Cinderella, then by implication, faith and charity are her ugly stepsisters. But in reality, both are beautiful and neither is envious. I just couldn't resist the temptation to make an off-Broadway appearance as a fairy godmother. Nevertheless, while the wand is mine for this evening, the magic, as you all know, is from René Girard. Grant has honored me very greatly by inviting me to talk about hope at this colloquium, where we're being asked to be constructively self-critical with relation to Girard's thought and our use of it. One of the comments I've heard most frequently about René's final book, Battling to the End, is that he's very apocalyptic in his assessment of where we are going and the underlying trends at work, and that there's precious little room in his account for hope. What I'll try to do this evening is to challenge not the first part of that assessment, but the second, that there is precious little room for hope. And this is not because I find hidden signs of hope scattered among the pages of the book, but because I think the assessment makes a category mistake about the relationship between apocalyptic thinking, on the one hand, and hope. Apocalyptic or catastrophist thinking involves a certain assessment of the future. Hope is a theological virtue qualifying the present. The confusion between these two helps neither. And, as I hope to show, René's mimetic anthropology offers us a very good way into making sense of the latter. What I would like to have done by the end of this evening is sparked a reassessment of our take on Battling to the End, which I hope, and I should say I can hardly refer to that text at all, but such that the relationship between hope and darkness may be more easily found. The Three Ugly Sisters. Many of us live with a characterization of each of the three theological virtues, faith, hope, and charity, that's run from within by at least a strong residue of a modern individualistic picture of the self. The result is that without our being able to help it, we find ourselves living a caricature of what those virtues are. So, faith becomes a counterfactual ideological position called belief that we are emotionally blackmailed into holding if we want to be saved. You must launch a moonshot into the void concerning the existence of God and the effect of Jesus on the world. And whether or not there is anything there, you're being prepared to launch the moonshot and to provide strenuous emotional fuel for it is somehow considered meritorious. Charity then appears as a huge demand on the will to continue to think positively of and act generously towards others, and especially the bastards, whoever they may be. Despite your disliking and disapproving of them in almost every way, once again, as though a certain self-punitive effort in forcing yourself to hold a positive attitude towards what you really don't like were especially meritorious. And hope becomes a polite way of talking about wishful thinking, a way to put a positive spin on the loss of any firm expectation that such and such a good thing might happen to you. Do you really think you've got a snowball's chance in hell of such and such an award? Not really, but I live in hope. As though hope were an emission of longing into a vacuum. What remains when there is no real expectation? But this is no more than a positive emotional spin on wishful thinking, dressing up resignation as a virtue. Well, as I trust is apparent, these three simulacra have little or nothing to do with the theological virtues as traditionally understood. What I propose to do with you this evening is to show just how much more clearly hope, alongside the other virtues, can come to be seen for what it is when we reimagine the anthropology that underpins it, following the interindividual understanding of mimetic desire as elaborated by René Girard, and in particular as developed by Jean-Michel Bougouvillon, known to many of you here. A little point too, what is a theological virtue? Well, before we get to the theological part, first of all, what is a virtue? A virtue is a stable disposition for the good, which has been generated in you through your habitual response to this or that set of circumstances. So, a brave person is one in whom the stable disposition of not allowing their actions to be dominated by fear when faced with danger has become a recognizable characteristic, such that it helps define who they really are. This, for example, by contrast with someone who feels no fear and so does not properly assess danger, or with someone who has occasional bouts of chemically induced bravado leading them to reckless behavior, or by someone whose actions, when faced with danger, are habitually dominated by fear, someone we would call a coward. Well, typically, the habitual responses that become stable in us are ones, as René Girard has always insisted, into which we are inducted by imitation. A good model, if we can avoid being drawn into rivalry with them, will induct us into acquiring the same stable dispositions as they. As we all know, this is an arduous and precarious process, since a healthy distance from our models is not easy to maintain. As we get closer to each other, we find ourselves flipping from emulation into rivalry, as though the stable disposition in question and the praise and the recognition that accompany it were a scarce commodity which we can only possess at our model's expense. I hope it's apparent, then, that a virtue is something relational, part of the way, starting from outside you, by which something is produced in you, becoming something that really is you, and thus has a regular, objective effect on how you relate to others. Well, if this then is what a virtue is, what's meant by a theological virtue? Well, it means that the other who produces in us the stable disposition in question is God. Naturally, if you start from an individualistic psychology, where your desire starts in you, then this will have to seem somewhat magical. God illumines your mind in some direct way, maybe by some sort of zapping, so that you're able to know something that is not at all naturally obvious. Or God empowers you to resign waiting in the face of scarcely imaginable pie in the sky. Or strengthens your will to do what you know to be right in your relationships with others, however painful and unpleasant that may turn out to be for you or for them. However, a mimetic understanding of the psychology in question produces both a saner and a much more traditional picture. For faith is the stable disposition produced in you by God's truthfully persuading you through the presence of Jesus' life and death that you are loved by God as you are. Through this persuasion, over time, the Greek word faith and persuasion is the same word, pistis. Through this persuasion over time, you are able habitually to relax into that being known by God as you are with love, and to live without fear of death. That being known by God as you are with love is already something in the face of which death is moot, since for God, knowing someone, loving them, and holding them deathlessly in being are inseparable, as Jesus both taught and demonstrated. So, through the stable disposition of being persuaded, coming to characterize you, you are already starting to live deathlessly exactly in your being held in the knowledge that you're loved by one for whom death is not. Because of this, the ordinary emotional correlate of faith is relaxation. You're not having to strain belief towards something unknown. Rather, the effort, strain, and hard work is on the part of the one who is trying to persuade you to relax into being known as you are. Despite all obstacles of shame, ignorance, and inability to accept yourself as lovable, that one is inducing in you the stable disposition of being persuaded by that one, which persuasion, or faith, the Greek word is the same, is itself God's gift in you. This gift in you is in you as a certain publicly detectable way of being present in the world, which has incidence in all your relationships. Charity, then, is the stable disposition by which God empowers us habitually to receive ourselves through giving ourselves away. Once again, typically we imagine that charity involves a self-starting exercise of the will by which we must love God above all things and others as ourselves. And the more difficult and demanding this is, the better. Such a demand very quickly turns us into generous, seeming emotional blackmailers, run by all the pathologies of self-sacrifice that Girard has so well illuminated. Nevertheless, a sane anthropology, or a sane anthropology, or indeed anyone who remembers the first epistle of St. John, where it says, "In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that God loved us, and sent his Son to the expiation for our sins." As anyone who remembers that knows perfectly well, it's because we are loved first that we are able to love. The presence of real love towards others in a person's life is the sure sign that they're operating out of being loved first. The reason that this is important is because being empowered to receive yourself through giving yourself away is how we come to share in the life of God. For of God we can say that God's very being consists in giving God's self away. Hence, the abundance of everything that is, and the self-effacement of the one bringing it into being. So charity is the stable disposition by which we are gradually inducted by Jesus, the crucified and risen one, that is to say, the human self-giving one who received himself fully through giving himself away, into sharing the inner life of God already in this life, and the emotional correlate that goes along with this habitual disposition is joy. Well, there are no shortage of books about the theological virtues of faith and charity. And this is, I suspect, in large part because traditionally each has been linked with a human faculty, intellect in the case of faith, and will in the case of charity, about which we have not lacked intelligent conversation, even when that conversation has been locked down in individualist and mentalist presuppositions. But it may surprise you to know that the human faculty traditionally associated with the theological virtue of hope is memory. And it's much harder to come by in literature on the theological anthropology of memory. So I'd like to suggest, as an initial definition, and before we move into exploring the role of memory, that the theological virtue of hope is the stable disposition by which we allow ourselves habitually to be stretched by an apparently future fullness that is coming upon us into receiving who we really are while undergoing a recasting of our past. If the emotional correlate of faith is relaxation and of charity, joy, then the emotional correlate of hope is a sense of being stretched into an exciting adventure with the rejuvenating zest that accompanies that sense. However, before we move into a detailed discussion of hope and what is specific to it, I'd like to make one further general point about why the theological virtues are central to Christianity. My point is linked to the same critique of the deficient and crippling individualistic view which we seem to hold as normal. Where faith is is a straining to hold a counterfactual belief system. Hope is a wishful thinking in a vacuum. And charity is a will or dogged determination to goodness. And after a bit, the only element left to matter in Christian life comes to be morals, since that's the only element which actually has any real bite on our day-to-day life. So, if we are Protestant, the Bible becomes a fundamental law book for morals. And if we are Catholic, the Church becomes an unquestionable morals policing operation. Because all the other stuff, faith, grace, liturgy, prayer, the life of the Spirit, hope, and heaven, is all too vague and insubstantial seeming to have much incidence on our day-to-day lives. Well, I hope to convince you that this is nonsense. Faith, hope, and charity are not vague, somewhat wishful, intellectual sideshows about which it's nice to know, while the real work, learning properly approved behaviour, goes on elsewhere. They are not something extra to go along with morals. They are the three structuring dimensions of what Paul refers to as huiothesia, and which is normally translated as sonship, adoption as son, or being turned into a son. In English, we face the difficulty that the gendered nouns son and daughter have different roots, so we can't easily translate huiothesia without sexism. Filiation, in Romance languages, is a better match since it works for both filia and filius. Our alternative gender-free expression, becoming a child of God, is not entirely felicitous, since child has connotations of infantile or minor status, which is not what huiothesia is about at all. And children of God is even less helpful, since it leaves us as a plural collective, where Paul saw huiothesia as turning us, admittedly plural offspring, into something singular. So I propose somewhat perversely, the old English term bairn is still in use in northern parts of Great Britain to refer personally to offspring of either sex. This is not because it is a better translation, it isn't, but because by its oddness it may serve to remind us of some of the resonances which our usual translations of huiothesia tend to obscure. Faith, hope, and charity are the three structuring dimensions of bairndom, the stable dispositions by which we are inducted into being bairn of God. But please notice what this means. There are not, in one compartment of our lives, the theological virtues, and in another, morals or ethical behavior issues. No, our bairndom of God unfurls itself, deploys itself in our lives through each one of us being inducted into having the stable dispositions of knowing as we are known, and thus relaxing, of being stretched into a future freedom that is already coming upon us, and, as these operate, of being empowered to receive ourselves through giving ourselves away, thus to share the life of God. These stable dispositions induced in us actually turn us into who we are to be, and as they do so, we find ourselves inside us in and free owners of the reality of creation. In other words, these stable dispositions produced in us by God structure the operative center from which we live out our bairndom. The dispositions are totally non-directive, not telling us what to do. They give shape to the way we work out for ourselves what to do. And what we will want to do will flow from what we discover ourselves becoming. It's because of this that there are no specifically Christian morals. There is just what it is authentically good for humans to do, as discovered from within by those who are in the process of coming into ownership of everything as bearer of God. Essential to this picture of us being stretched into bounded by what's coming upon us is the image of the heir, spelled H-E-I-R. Excuse pronunciation issues here. H-E-I-R. The image of an heir, an inheritor, which Paul also uses. I'd like to take time with this image, since it helps us avoid one of the major pitfalls in any discussion of hope, which is the tendency to regard hope as essentially a subjective matter, a form of inner assurance or conviction, something independent of objective reality. That would be misleading. The whole point of being an heir is that your inheritance is not some vague hope that might or might not someday come upon you, like winning the lottery. Rather, it is an entirely realistic expectation that is coming closer to you as a promise moves towards its fulfillment. For as long as the person whose heir you are inches towards death. And from the moment that that person dies, it is in fact unalterably yours. For a properly executed will is a promise made before witnesses that is fulfilled on death and cannot be altered posthumously. It's quite a simple definition. So, at the moment my mum died a couple of years ago, my sister, my brother, and I were already, under law, the equal owners of everything promised us in her will. Now, in fact, processing a will takes time. We didn't have immediate access to what was, in fact, already ours. First, the estate had to be reckoned for probate, which takes forever. Then Her Majesty's saber-toothed inheritance tigers took 40% of the total, as is their money. Finally, about 18 months after my mum's death, the rest was divided out as specified in her will. Now, my relationship to that inheritance during the 18-month gap was not one of wishful thinking or of longing in a vacuum. Something that was already substantially mine in law was gradually coming closer and closer to being mine in practice, meaning being at my disposal. The difference between wishful thinking on the one hand and objective expectation on the other is very clear. Wishful thinking is what any of us engage in who play the lottery and fantasize about what we might do on the exceedingly remote off chance of winning it. Unless we are mad, such wishful thinking does not cause us to alter our pattern of living as if we were certain of something. Expectation of an inheritance, on the other hand, actually does have a palpable effect on us during the period of time between the promise being made, the promise becoming formally fulfilled on death, and what was promised actually coming to be at our disposal. So, as my mum's inheritance moved from promise to formal fact towards something disposable, it produced a change in me. It caused me gradually to start adjusting my plans, my sense of possibilities, and so on. It was already some months before it actually came into my hands, shaping me from within so that I would be more realistically be equal to the privilege of possession. This shaping me from within started by stretching my imagination and gradually my habits and my relationships, for instance, with both my siblings and my son, my confidence with relation to my creditors, and so on. By the time the 18 months were over, I was a recognizably different, publicly different actor than I had been before. I stress all of this because it bears directly on what is probably the most famous line concerning hope in the New Testament, Hebrews 11:1. It comes, every version has a different translation. Now, faith is the hypostasis, literally the substance of things hoped for, the elenchos, literally the proof of things not seen. So, the verse is slightly misleading, since, as no less an authority than Pope Benedict points out, it elides, brings together faith and hope. Nevertheless, the verse reads entirely differently, depending on whether we're talking about something subjective or something objective. So, the Revised Standard Version gives a subjective sense to both the words hypostasis and elenchos, yielding this translation. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Does that ring well? Is that a translation of the as though faith or hope are properly described as certain subjective states in us, assurance and conviction. The sense which I'm trying to bring out is something much more like this paraphrase. Now, our being persuaded, yielding as it does the substance of what is hoped for, turns us into a demonstration or proof of what is not seen. It's exactly in this latter way that an inheritance works. At the testator's death, the promised inheritance is substantially mine, even when it is not yet in my possession. And because of that, I already now find myself starting to become a publicly visible demonstration, a reliable sign of what is on its way. Who I am is objectively being altered as someone else's promise, their desire, moves towards its fulfillment in my reception of it. Another of the perplexities bequeathed to us by an individualist and mentalist account of the self is that of theological virtues having to be produced in us directly by God, without any human intermediaries. With this, not only does hope become a longing in a vacuum, but the whole account of hope which the New Testament offers us becomes incomprehensible. For what is central to the New Testament account of hope is that hope was opened up for us definitively as an entirely new possibility by Jesus doing something. In other words, hope is not magically worked up in us by intervention from a removed divine other. Hope is produced in us anthropologically, at this level, just like any other virtue, by another human being. It was what Jesus did on the human, anthropological level that opened up for us the possibility of seeing something as available to us through stretching. He humanly created it and its attractiveness by modeling the desire to achieve it, which we receive as we emulate it. What was it that he did? He first created the context in which his going to his death was able to be understood, even if only posthumously, as an act of obedient generosity of the sort that was not run by death, fear, its shame, and our impotence in its faith. An act that could only be carried out by someone who was not himself run in any way by those forces. Then he genuinely acted that out, fully, finally, unto its last consequences. Finally, his resurrection revealed that what he had been saying and doing had been empowered all along by the true sense of everything that is, of all becoming, abundant, self-giving life, inseparable from the glory of God. In other words, his resurrection was not a post-mortem coda to a well-lived life. It was the sign that the bright effervescence of reality, of what was always really the case, had at last been able to break definitively into the midst of an unnaturally darkened human life and culture. This eruption was wrought by a human being having actually lived and gone to his death without being run by, determined by, frightened by, or cowed into submission by death and its pious seeming outliers. In doing so, he creatively modeled the possibility of any of us receiving the contagion of what he had set loose in the world. Contagion, to use Sebastian Moore's lovely phrase, which we're not to mention. I want to stress this, because it means that what Jesus opened up for us, and what he promised us, and what he fulfilled for us in going to his death, was access to the fullness of the deathless reality that creation really is. And it is this sense of the stretching towards us of the fullness of what creation really is, and of our being stretched beyond ourselves into being turned into people who are up to the privilege of being the heir and insider in it, that produces hope in us. Once you understand that Jesus did it for us, that he was the fulfillment of God's ancient promise to us, and that that promise was fulfilled in his death, then once the testator dies, the inheritance is already there and starting to be instantiated in us as we are inducted into full position, into full possession of what both is and is not yet ours. But the whole point of hope is that it is linked to reality. The new birth into a living hope to which 1 Peter refers is not and never was a private, religious, or moral reality. It was and is a realignment of our whole way of being towards what really is, as what really is begins to manifest itself in us. It wasn't merely the case that Jesus died and his resurrection revealed eternal life, though that did happen. His death and resurrection had content. He occupied the place of shame, degradation, curse. purpose and impotence. The lot of the innocent victim who was cast out by the coming together of the forces of civic and religious leadership, and he occupied it voluntarily and generously. This meant that Jesus' presence as crucified and risen victim opens up the new creation, not as a neutral fact, as though he were simply revealing to us the existence of a previously unknown continent. Rather, he was opening it up in the only way in which it could conceivably be accessed by us. Forgiveness. For that is how the new creation retrofits us and aligns us with itself. What we call the forgiveness of sins is not a moralistic decree made by a magnanimous victim. The forgiveness of sins becomes possible because Jesus occupied the ground zero of what made human culture viable, the undoing from within of the constructive victimary mechanism by which we build and maintain human togetherness and which has configured our humanity and all our institutions. Why is this important? Because opening up the reality of what is, without simultaneously deconstructing us, and without us enabling to be disentangled from the falsity of what we were making from it, would leave us with our imaginations still so formed by what we thought we were, that we would be unable to be stretched into what we are becoming. Forgiveness is how we describe the way that what we are to be starts to apply itself in our lives, unattaching, letting us go from what we thought we were. Our being personally, narratively involved in that process is something usually realized by us long after that forgiveness has started to manifest itself in our lives. That narrative involvement comes when we are finally able to recognize the ways in which we have been bound and to consent to a realignment of our being that has long been nudging us into appropriating by saying the word I, as in, I'm sorry. What on earth have I done? Please forgive me. In other words, absolutely essential to any understanding of hope is that it reaches us through and as a restructuring of memory. And now I think it worthwhile spending a little time thinking about this. For memory is not something we have. It is memory that enables there to be a me at all. Once again, the individualistic picture of who we are misleads us, for memory has a history. Indeed, it is what makes us historical, which means narrative animals possible. We do not know when physical location, something that was just there for many millions of years before us, started acquiring meaning for us. But a good bet is that tombs were the first places in a human sense, and that from them we started to make sense of space and make of it something in our image. Nor do we know when physical movement of bodies, animate or inanimate, something that was just there for many millions of years before us, started acquiring meaning for us as time. But a good bet is that it was related to how the definitive before and after of death became meaningful. There are many different ways of describing how this ape invented ourselves by stumbling into a relationship with place, how endless repetition leading to nowhere in particular came to find itself impregnated with significance, leading both to sounds becoming language and to our discovering ourselves through time. The entirely contingent nature of our being discovered by place and time coming together, and the feedback loop which this inaugurated through ever more significant imitation and repetition in such a way that memory started to give us a narrative, that's part of any account of hominization. Girard's has at least the value of being extraordinarily parsimonious, for the aleatory victim mechanism he describes, stumbled into by hypermimetic apes over hundreds of thousands of years, brings together exactly the qualities of repetition of gesture and of sound, such that our being invented by time and by place would be structured from within by the sacred, that is to say, by what we now see as victimary distortion. The sense of our being stretched by memory into a greater reality than we knew must have multiplied over millennia as ritual repetition threw up monuments which themselves started to stretch our memories further as we lived with physical evidence of a past beyond our lifespan, beyond the lifespan of the 20 and then 30 and then 40 years or so for which living memories of particular events are available. The difference made to this by the first scratchings of literacy, probably an account-keeping mechanism, which means a way of measuring and assessing debt, which means a mechanism for deferring vengeance, is all part of what produced the enormously subtle and complex memory holders and inductors, which we call culture, and which form each of us from within. So it is the case that each of us has a memory induced in us as we are stretched into imitating gesture and sound, and that the flourishing of a healthy memory is the ability of its bearer to share and to negotiate their relationships narratively with the we that has brought that particular I into being. Memory is the way human narrative reality stretches us into itself. I hope you can see then why forgiveness is essential both to the virtue of hope and to our being stretched into reality. For hope is how God's narrative comes to be lived out in our lives as a stable human reality. It is how, if you like, God, who is without time, befriends the human narrative structured by time. And God's narrative is of God's self as human, giving God's self up to death as our victim, occupying the place of shame, loss, destruction, fear, curse, and fatality, so that we might come to enjoy God's presence. This human narrative of self-giving is not simply an act of pardon for miscreants' past. It is the restructuring from within of our process of harmonization. For if imitation and repetition have become suffused with the victory mechanism, then in all human attempts at being, we, and any of our cultures or groupings, is grasping onto being voluntary, so that we can hold on to a self, an identity, a belonging. But the self-giving victim, having become an ever-living source of forgiveness, undoes both time and space, such that neither structures our being and our belonging in the same way. If I start as one who has imitated, repeated, and grasped himself into being, then my capacity to imagine who I might become will be dictated by what I have emphatically participated in embedding myself into. However, if I am being stretched into receive my being from a not yet that is coming upon me, then part of that being stretched is my being enabled to stand loose from the ways I have hitherto been bound into what has made me. If you could stay with me a little further, I trust you will see how important it is to understand that neither is hope something principally concerned with the future, nor is memory something principally concerned with the past. Any of us can understand this quite easily. We find ourselves involved in something. Let us say, being Aztecs in Tenochtitlan. And for a time, it defines who we were and are, and shapes the sort of future we might imagine. Later, something quite unexpected happens, say the arrival of Spaniards and horses, which we could not have imagined, and which alters the whole of our relationship to our past, such that we begin to tell an entirely different story about what we were doing in the past before the unexpected thing happened. Something that was in an unknown future in the past radically alters the past that was past, such that the quality of our present, who we are now, say, as modern Mexicans, is quite different. The more definitive the future changes, the more definitive is its alteration of the past. Not, of course, of empirical facts, but of the whole set of human relationships which alone give empirical facts their sense in the present. But what this means is that memory is not determined by the past. Memory is the way the apparent future structures the present by narrating the past. This also means that hope is not in principle about the future. It's the quality of the present that is made available in and through our being stretched by not yet coming upon us. And this seems to me to be something quite vital. Neither the past nor the future exist. Only the present exists. It is hope that empowers memory to enable us to live with a rich present, for that rich present is the only access we have to God. It's already an extraordinary and haphazard adventure for this ape to have invented itself into being a self-questioning dweller in time and space. Even more extraordinary, the God in whom there is neither time nor space should have opted to enter into our narratival world so as to make of those potentially futile and senseless elements the conditional possibility of us being present, with a rich enough sense of presence and awareness actually to be able to enjoy God. That is why, incidentally, it's enormously important that we understand that in what Catholics call, truly but with fear and trembling, the sacrifice of the Mass, we are not repeating a sacrifice. For repeating it would mean that Jesus' death had not undone identity grasped by repetition of time defined over against death. Rather, it's the case that because Jesus' death opened up hope for us, bringing an end to sacrifice, so the deliberately, historically opened reality of the new creation is just there, longingly drawing us in, restructuring us from within into being really present as humans able to participate in a real presence, which is in principle quite beyond any of us. I'd like to conclude this evening by looking at the relationship between hope and patience. Since in the wishful thinking model of hope, patience becomes a particularly unhelpful stable disposition, a passive-aggressive veneer of goodness while feeling impotent in the face of things that are wrong and hurtful. Once again, resignation dressed up as a virtue. But this sort of resignation is the offspring not of hope, but of despair. Nevertheless, if the theological anthropology I've been trying to set out for you has some value, then the relationship between hope and patience is entirely different and much more creative. For it's the sense of the real coming upon you and aligning you with itself that makes it possible to bear with tribulations without being reactive to them, not allowing them to get you down. And part of the wonder of this is that it opens up time. Where you have no hope, you're constantly at the mercy of what happens, and thus thoroughly reactive. Whereas hope is what allows you to take your time in the midst of tribulations, to do what you want to do, and thus to forge who you are becoming. And it is this being able to take our time and not be panicked that is conducive to the emergence of the creative, the technological, and the scientific spirit. In other words, patience, rather than being a form of resignation, is the stable disposition, true daughter of hope, of a certain hard-nosed and realistic insouciance in the face of real obstacles which are there, empowering its bearer to inhabit the present time creatively. Nothing victory or self-pitying about it at all. I trust, furthermore, that you may be able to see more clearly now why it is that I began by distinguishing between the apocalyptic reading of reality in which Jia engages in battle to the end and the theological virtue of hope. We're all aware of rose-tinted approaches to reality which mark a profound inability or unwillingness to face up to how difficult and dangerous we are to each other and to our biosphere. We're fairly easily able to sense that this or that expression of optimism marks a profound despair. But it is only the person, such as the author of Battling to the End, who has been stretched by hope into an habitually patient attitude towards everything that is, who is able to sit alongside hopelessness, give an accurate assessment of it, and not be run by it. That one of us has been stretched slowly and patiently into being able to get alongside the heart of darkness, and yet not be scandalized by it, is one of the surest signs that the theological virtue of hope is operative.